Now let's get back to our original problem. So our original problem was a simple example where we had two particles, and I'm going to write this again, A and B. So A moving with velocity V minus, B moving with VB minus, and then there is an impact, the two particles come together, and then after the impact, you have A and B moving with different velocities, and we were interested in the post-impact velocities, right? Okay, so we saw that for the system, for A and B together, we could apply conservation of linear momentum principle, and we could write MA VA minus plus MB VB minus equal to MA VA plus MB VB plus. Okay, and we had too many unknowns over here. In fact, two unknowns if we were looking for post-impact velocities and we knew pre-impact velocities. Now we have obtained a relationship which says that E is equal to integral Q dt over integral P dt, which is nothing but ratio of the impulse of force of restitution over impulse of force of deformation. Now, integral Q dt was obtained as MA over MA plus MB times VB plus minus VA plus divided by, this was MA, forgot MB over here, MB divided by MA plus MB, and this was VA minus minus VB minus. So these are common, so they cancel, and that means E can also be written as, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to write VB plus minus VA plus in the numerator, and the denominator I'm going to change this to VB minus minus VA minus, since I've flipped these two. So I have to add a negative sign, right? So this is the expression for coefficient restitution that we'll be using from now onward. So it's actually easy to remember. If you look at this, it starts with a minus sign. And the numerator, we have relative velocity of separation, right? So VB plus minus VA plus is basically telling you what is the velocity of B with respect to A after the impact. So this is relative velocity of separation. Separation is after the impact. And in the denominator, you have velocity of B with respect to A before the impact. So this we'll call relative velocity of approach, because this is before the impact, right? So you can pick any particle to be A or B. You just need to be consistent. If you're picking the velocity B with respect to A, then that's what you need to write in both the numerator and denominator, right? So which one you pick as A or B is not important, right? So it's easy to remember, E is equal to minus in the numerator, relative velocity of separation, in the denominator, relative velocity of approach. So this second relationship is going to give us the second equation to solve the problem, all right? So we would have to know E. So if the question says this is a perfectly elastic collision, then E would be equal to 1. Right? If it says it's a plastic collision, then E would be equal to 0. If it says it's a perfectly plastic collision, then you know A and B will be together, and that means A and B will have the same velocity after the impact. So knowing the value of E would allow you to solve for the post-impact velocities from these two equations. So this was a scenario where we had a direct central impact. Why was it a direct central impact? Because the line of action, this is the line of action or line of impact, went through the center of masses of the particles, which would always be the case because these are the particles with no size and shape. And this was a direct impact because the approach velocities, at least one of the approach velocities, at least one of the pre-impact velocities, were along the line of action. The second kind of impact that you see with the particle is an oblique central impact. So let's look at an example of that as well. So example of an oblique central impact. Okay, so an oblique central impact is where you have two particles A and B. So I'm going to draw them at the time of impact. There is a tangent line, and then there is a normal line. Okay, that's your normal line. This is your line of impact. Okay. And clearly this is a central impact because the line of impact is going through the center of masses. But now it's an oblique impact because A is coming in at a velocity whose direction is not necessarily along line of impact, right? So this is an oblique central impact scenario. What about B? Well, B could be coming at another angle, okay? So that would be VB minus. Now remember, for something to qualify as an oblique impact, only one of the pre-impact velocities has to be in a direction, not necessarily along line of impact, okay? That's the only constraint. The other one could be along line of impact. So when you have a scenario like this, how would you solve the problem? Well, in this case, you clearly have a two-dimensional phenomena going on, right? The previous example, there is central impact. You could just constrain the analysis to one direction. In this case, it was less is positive x direction. And we didn't really have to worry about the I hat and J hat, the unit vectors, because everything was along one line. Now here, we would have to worry about that, right? So what we're going to do is we'll say that this is the tangent direction and this is the normal direction, okay? So we'll indicate it as tangent normal. Sometimes, you know, textbook may solve the problem as saying this is x-axis, this is the y-axis, but it doesn't matter. Essentially, the idea is that you have two axes which are perpendicular to each other, okay? All right, so now we have a tangent direction, we have a normal direction. We want to figure out if we can use momentum conservation principle to solve this problem, right? And if we can, then would it give a sufficient number of equations to solve the problem? In all likelihood, that won't be the case. You would have to use the coefficient restitution formula as well to solve the problem, all right? So we'll start by drawing a free body diagram, okay? First, we'll do it for the system. So free body diagram of the system. So at the time of impact, you know, we have A, we have B. That's your tangent line, that's your normal line, okay? And on these two particles, what are the forces acting? Well, we have the normal reaction from the ground, we have the weight, but both of them are non-impulsive forces, so we don't need to show them. Then we have the forces of impulse, in this case are internal to the particles, so we don't show it for the system. So if you assume a frictionless surface, then there are no forces that would change the linear momentum of the total system, right? Okay, which means that we can conserve linear momentum of the system, and we can conserve it along both tangent and normal direction, right? Because everything is happening in a plane. So we can say MA VA minus vector plus MB VB minus vector equal to MA VA plus MB VB plus. Okay, now each of these vectors can be resolved along tangent and normal direction, right? So any velocity, let's say velocity of A before impact, can be written as velocity of A, okay, along the tangent direction, right? So we'll say this is ET sub hat plus VA minus along normal direction EN hat, right? So we could say this is our, you know, E sub T hat. You can pick whichever positive direction you want, it doesn't matter, right? Okay, so that would be velocity of A along the tangent and normal direction, right? We can resolve it that way, okay? And we can do it the same thing for VB minus, VA plus, VB plus, right? So this is a vector equation. This is a vector equation, which will basically resolve into two scalar equations along tangent and normal direction, right? And since the total forces acting on the particle is zero, that means that the linear momentum is conserved along both tangent and normal direction, right? So we can write this in two different directions. So along tangent direction, so let's say along tangent direction, we have MA VA minus along tangent direction plus MB VB minus along tangent direction, and that should be equal to the momentum along tangential direction of the system after the impact. Okay, so that's equation one. Along normal direction, we can write the same thing. Along normal direction, we have MA VB minus normal plus MB VB minus equal to MA VA plus MB VB plus along normal direction. Okay, so if I wanted to know what these quantities were, it would be a simple matter of resolving them, right? You would have to know what this angle is. Let's say this is theta A minus, you know, let's say this is theta B minus, then VA minus along tangential direction would be VA minus sine theta A minus, right? Along normal direction would be VA minus cosine theta A minus, right? Okay, so you can resolve them along tangent and normal direction. So this is what we get for the system, right? Now let's look at free body diagram of A alone. Free body diagram of A. So here is our A. That's our tangent direction, E sub t hat. And this is our normal direction, right? So I'm just drawing A alone, okay? So what are the forces acting on A? We are only looking for impulsive forces, not the non-impulsive forces. And remember, gravity, elastic forces can never be impulsive forces because their magnitude is always going to be limited. So the only force acting on A is the impulsive force from B acting on A, right? That force is an impulsive force, which we didn't show before for the system because it was internal to the system, right? So which direction this R is acting? It's acting along the direction of line of impact, right? That's the direction it is acting in. So what can we say about linear momentum of A before and after the impact? Is it going to be conserved? It is definitely not going to be conserved in general because there is an external force acting on it, right? But if you look carefully, and this is important, if you look carefully, you can see that this impulsive force is acting only along normal direction. It is not acting along tangential direction, which tells you that actually linear momentum along tangential direction would be conserved because there is no external force acting in that direction. So when you're solving problems in this module involving impact of multiple particles in a plane, you should pay attention to the direction in which maybe no force is acting on an individual particle. And that would allow you to write one more equation without which you won't be able to solve the problem completely, right? So we can say that no momentum conservation along normal direction, but along tangent direction, the momentum is conserved. So before the impact, the momentum of A along tangential direction is Va minus t, and that should be equal to Ma times velocity A plus along tangential direction. And since Ma is common, so we say that Va minus in tangent direction is same as Va plus along tangential direction, right? So that could become your equation two. We already wrote one equation. We actually wrote two equations. This is actually equation three, okay? All right, so what about B? Let's draw a free body diagram of B and try to do something similar. So free body diagram of B says that here is our tangent direction and here is our B. Okay, that's your normal direction. That's E n hat. That's E sub t hat. The force of impulse acting in the opposite direction is R, right? So we can again say that there is no momentum conservation along normal direction for B, but there is momentum conservation along tangential direction. So VB minus along tangential direction is same as VB plus along tangential direction. And that's equation four. Okay, so let's go back and see how many unknowns we really have, right? We have four unknowns. We have VA plus, VB plus tangent direction, VA plus normal direction, and VB plus along normal direction. So we actually need, you know, total four equations, you know, to solve for all of these quantities, right? Okay. So at this point, you know, you're looking at this problem and saying, hey, we have four equations, one, two, three, and four. We have four unknowns, so we should be able to solve for it, right? Not so fast. The reason is because we actually don't have four independent equations here. We actually have only three independent equations. So how do I see that? So if you look at three and four, if I multiply three with MA and I multiply four with MB, and I add actually three and four together, I will actually find number one equation. Okay, so by multiplying three with MA and adding it with, after multiplying four with MB, we actually get nothing but equation one. So these four equations are not independent. So we essentially have only three independent equations, but we have four unknowns. So we need one more equation that relates these post-impact velocities with pre-impact velocities, right? Where would that fourth independent equation come from? That would come from the definition of coefficient of restitution. Okay, now at this point, this is important, and so please pay attention. The coefficient of restitution has, in this expression, VB plus VA plus VB minus VA minus, right? But in this problem, where two particles are moving in a plane, we actually have velocities along both tangent and normal direction. So the question is, what should be the velocities that should be plugged in here? They cannot be the vector quantities because E is actually a scalar, right? So you cannot divide two vector quantities and get a scalar out of it. which means that these velocities in the coefficient restitution formula have to be some scalar values. So which scalar values they should be? So in this equation for coefficient restitution, the velocities have to be along normal direction. Why should they be only along normal direction? Why shouldn't we care about the tangent direction? The reason is, when you derive this expression for E, you would notice that we wrote the impulse of force of deformation as well as force of restitution, right? And that's how we obtain the value of E. Which direction Q and P were acting? They were acting along the normal direction, the line of action or the line of impact, right? Since this is obtained from the forces that act in the direction of normal, or the direction in which the forces act, the velocities also have to be along that direction, right? So which means that when you write the E formula over here, you will have minus VB plus along normal direction minus VA plus along normal direction over VB minus along normal direction minus VA minus along normal direction. So let me write this in right over here. Only use velocities along normal or line of impact direction. Okay, so this is an important point to remember. When you write the formula for E, all the velocities have to be along the normal or the line of impact direction. So this gives us our fourth independent equation. Let me call it 5. So out of these 5, there are only 4 independent. Okay, so from these 5 equations, now you can solve for all the post-impact velocities.